It was 1851 in a western wilderness. A Major James Savage led a volunteer battalion against the native Indians. Their aim was to corral the Indians and ship them to a reservation. After days, they stumbled onto a valley.
Whoa.
The likes of which they had never seen. Yankee Indian hunters had stumbled upon a place near what's now called Inspiration Point. They were the first non-Indians ever to enter the Yosemite Valley. Today, Yosemite National Park is entered by millions. Those who come here strictly for recreation. And there are those who come as though on a pilgrimage for spiritual renewal. Most visitors' reasons for coming fall somewhere in between. Yosemite spreads over 1,170 square miles of western Sierra wilderness in the state of California. It is 350 miles from Los Angeles and 193 miles from San Francisco. It encompasses two rivers, 429 lakes, five major waterfalls, and groves of trees that are the largest living things on Earth. It was millions of years in the making. But millions of years aren't that long in geological time. The immense upwarp of granite inched to the dizzy heights we see today. Wind-blown snows were lashed upon the summits, snows that never melted. Ice coalesced into glaciers. And these vast glaciers would break from their moorings and grind down, moving over the granite like buffers, scouring and polishing. But should we forget the force of glacial ice, we're reminded of it by rocks, boulders, towering granite walls, grooved and striated as though by gigantic claws. Should we forget the weight of these glaciers, 100 million tons, we're reminded by the fact that they polished whole cliff sides to the smoothness of glass. Should we forget the force of glacial waters, we see where gorges, ravines, great chasms have been sculpted by it. Should we forget that this land had been thick with forests of sequoias, the biggest living things on Earth, small groves of these great trees endure, defying change, defying time itself. Should we forget that before the creeping, crushing juggernaut of glaciers, regal beasts roamed here? From the family of monstrous prehistoric bears came the prowling black bear that we know today. From the saber-toothed tiger, the mountain lion. From the fierce dire wolf, the stealthy coyote. Now that flowing water had returned and warmth, this land was again a home for myriad forms of life. The mule deer, the raccoon, the acorn woodpecker, the yellow-bellied marmot, the tree squirrel and the ground squirrel, and the rattlers, and the red-tailed hawks that hunted them. And should we forget that this abundance of wildlife first drew human hunters some 4,000 years ago? These hunters and seed gatherers, these Adams and Eves of this American Eden, left us their spear points and these mortar holes where they had ground acorns into meal. Over tens of centuries, hunters and seed gatherers came and went. These primal people dwelt in harmony with their surroundings. They took what they needed. Compared with us, they lived in original innocence. In these last centuries, this land was settled by a Miwok people who saw the valley as Awani, a great gaping mouth. And these people became the Awanichi, the people of the gaping mouth. They attributed the land's creation to Coyote Man and Frog Man.
Coyote Man and Frog Man were afloat on a raft. Frog Man dove down into the water and came up with mud. Of this mud, Coyote Man made the land. Then he made us, the people. He made many different people who spoke and lived in different ways.
To the Awanichi, the valley was permeated by the Great Spirit. To them, the waterfalls cascaded with spirit life. Their hunters spoke with the spirits of the quarry that they stalked. They imitated the virtues of their fellow creatures of the lofty crags above the valley, the sure-footedness of the mountain sheep, the sharp sight of the peregrine falcon. The Awanichi lived in cone-shaped dwellings of bark built over fire pits. Black oaks were an important source of food. These were acorn gatherers. In autumn, each family gathered some 500 pounds of them. Acorns were pounded to a flour, leached, and then boiled into mush. This mush was the staple of the Awanichi diet. Unreached by the 18th century Spanish missions that dotted California, the Awanichi lived from year to year to the seasonal rhythms of the valley. Then, in 1833, a party of pale-faced trappers, under the leadership of a six-footer named Joseph Walker, traveled these forests near what is now the Tioga Road. They were the first white men to lay eyes on the valley. It seems that the Awanichi weren't much disturbed by them. Only 15 years later, the Sierra Nevada would see an end to innocence. Gold. Gold was discovered in the Sierra Nevada in a foothill stream north of the valley. Gold. The call sounded in St. Louis and Philadelphia and Boston. In Europe, farmers left their farms, parsons their parishes, husbands their wives and children. The tough and the lucky made it to California. The Indians were appalled. More and more whites, fueled by hope and greed, kept coming into the foothills. Soon there would be more people than the land could support. With their survival threatened, the Indians attacked a store that had stood on this site, run by a trader named James D. Savage. The Awanichi were implicated in the attack. That was the beginning of the Mariposa Indian War. A volunteer battalion was formed. Savage was put in command. The task was to drive the culprit Indians out of their homeland to the confines of a reservation. In pursuing the Indians, the curtain opened on the secret valley of the Awanichi. Major Savage's comment,
"It's a hell of a place."
On a second foray by the battalion, under a Captain Bowling, the hiding Awanichi were smoked out and shipped to a reservation. The crafty old chief, Tenaya, surrendered. He was marched into camp, where he saw the blood-smeared corpse of one of his sons. He glared at the commanding officer.
"Kill me, Captain. You kill the child of my heart. Why not kill the father? But you shall not live in peace. I will be with the spirits, among the rocks, the waterfalls, in the rivers, and in the wind."
Today, this trio of angled slopes is called Three Brothers for the three sons of Chief Tenaya. The men of the Mariposa Battalion were the first non-Indians to enter the valley. Their job was to rout the Awanichi, and that was that. But one of their number, a 27-year-old named Lafayette Bunnell, was awestruck by what he saw. He, like his fellow soldiers, knew the Awanichis by the name Yosemites. So he suggested that they name the valley Yosemite. The name stuck. Blinded to loveliness by the lure of gold, for the next 5 years, men ignored the mistakenly named Yosemite. Then, in 1855, a James Hutchings, a magazine publisher, led a party of sightseers to the area. In the party was Thomas Ayers, who made the first sketches of the valley. His sketches attracted more sightseers. Among them was Frederick Olmsted, who had co-designed New York Central Park. Olmsted was deeply moved by what he saw, so much so that he promoted the idea of Yosemite as a park. After being in the Stone Age for so many thousands of years, Yosemite was suddenly being hemmed in by industrial America. Gone was the creator Coyote Man. Gone the mythical bear and hawk. The spirit names the Indians knew were never learned. Sites were rechristened for Victorian American sensibilities. Cathedral Rocks, Half Dome, El Capitan. The Indians called these 620-foot falls Pohono, Puffing Wind. Victorians renamed them Bridal Veil. Among those interlopers in their bustles and their bowler hats, those vista hunters and souvenir gatherers were those who came to probe the secrets of Yosemite, beginning over a century of the hunting and gathering of scientific data. East Coast Americans, who had flocked to Niagara Falls for their honeymoons, gained new respect for the West when they learned that Yosemite Falls were the highest in the United States and the second highest in the world. In time, it was discovered that Yosemite rose upwards like a layer cake through different zones, each supporting its own flora and fauna, which were carefully classified. The bottom layer, closest to sea level, is in a chaparral zone. Here, summers are hot. There are oaks, greasewood, manzanita, all being scolded by raucous Steller's jays. The layers rising up to 6,500 feet are fragrant with incense cedars and ponderosa pines. At 10,000 feet, it's cold. Vegetation is more sparse. Lodgepole pine, white bark pine, aspen, juniper, western hemlock. Above the tree line is a topmost layer in the thin air of an alpine area. To the very present, the fact hunters and gatherers have classified 1,400 species of trees and plants, more than 230 species of birds, and 80 species of mammals. In 1855, Galen Clark, drawn to Yosemite because of poor health, was engaged as a surveyor. Within 2 years, he discovered the sequoias in what he called the Mariposa Grove of Big Trees. Here, Clark built a cabin. Subsequently, he became Yosemite's guardian. He's buried here in a grave which he dug for himself. Three small sequoia groves were discovered in Yosemite: Clark's Mariposa Grove and the Merced and Tuolumne Groves. Some of these trees stand almost 300 feet tall. There seems to be no limit to their growth. They do not die of old age. They're the most massive growing things on Earth, bigger than anything that ever lived on Earth. This tree is respectfully referred to as the grizzly giant. It has a volume of more than 30,000 cubic feet. The sequoia is also one of the oldest living things. When this tree was a seedling, mummies were still being sealed into the tombs of the Valley of the Kings. Ancient Greeks were building their temples when it was a sapling. It was growing strong and sturdy as Europe moved from the Dark Ages through the Middle Ages to the Renaissance. And World War II raged as these boughs were maturing. Strolling through these groves is like moving through another era, an era of oversize, of mastodons, dinosaurs. When the news of these mammoth trees was telegraphed back east, it was met with disbelief, ridicule. And when a 20-foot cross-section was shipped back as proof, it was decried as a hoax. But lumbermen weren't skeptical. One sequoia could yield as much wood as a whole acre of pine forest. So loggers descended upon the Sierras with a greed matched only by that of the gold seekers. Prospectors had already invaded Yosemite. Now an enterprising showman named James C. Adams came to capture bears, which he trained for public performances. His forays make up the plot of the motion picture Grizzly Adams. Yosemite was teetering into the cesspool of commercialism that fouled Niagara Falls. At one point, there was a bogus auction at which the Yosemite Valley was raffled off at a dollar a chance. Clearly, something had to be done. The war between the states was lumbering into its fourth agonizing year. General Sherman had yet to make his march to the sea, but during the previous year, General Grant had emerged victorious in his second bloody assault on Vicksburg. It was 1864. The muffled drums kept beating. No face showed the toll that this war was taking, more than the president's. Yet he had sworn to preserve the Union at all costs. Preservation was the cause, to preserve the watchword. Perhaps the beleaguered president had seen Yosemite on the canvases of Albert Bierstadt, a German-born artist who in 1863 had gone to the valley to paint. Perhaps, during the turmoil of war, peace in unspoiled nature, too, must be preserved. In any case, on June 30th of 1864, President Lincoln signed into law a bill granting the Yosemite Valley and the Mariposa Big Tree Grove to the state of California as a scenic preserve, held for public use, resort, and recreation. It was not yet a national park, for national parks were still in the future, but it was seen by some as a national resource. Signing a bill was one thing. Protecting Yosemite was quite another. The California Park Commission gamely took on the task. The Wells Fargo office speaks of an era when sightseers were trundled to the valley by stagecoach. There was even a jail. Here, in 1875, brothers by the name of Washburn built the Wawona Hotel, which is still in operation. Wawona is another native word that stuck. It means big trees. This is a restored homesteader's cabin. Since the signing of the Yosemite grant, this land was held in trust by the state of California for the people. Despite the law, those homesteaders clung to the land as though they owned it. Flocks of sheep were driven to the Yosemite's high meadows for grazing, dangerously close to the state reserve. The sheep not only destroyed the pastures by chomping through to the roots, but they spread diseases to the high-dwelling bighorns. In time, the mountain sheep of the area died out. Speculators from the east in search of gold and silver kept encroaching on the Grant territory. Mines were built, shafts bore into the earth, machinery manufactured in blighted factory towns east of the Mississippi was hauled in. An influx of 20,000 settlers was anticipated. Miners, mechanics, haulers, people whose 12-hour days of back-breaking work would render them indifferent to the beauties of the area. It was more than the fledgling state of California could cope with. Logging, mining, homesteading, and flocks of pasture-killing, disease-spreading sheep. Not since the advance of the great glaciers had this area known such threats. Yosemite needed a voice. Since the ringing of the Liberty Bell, Americans were driven to push westward. In one short century, they had stretched across the continent, adding star after star to the flag. This left them little time for the wonders of nature. Beauty went unrecognized unless there was a use for it. Utility was everything. The first white man to see the Grand Canyon dismissed it as being without utility. To the American pioneer, nature was an adversary to be conquered. Rivers were unpredictable bodies of water to be bridged, not admired. And mountains were hardly lovely, not when they stood in the way to the other side. To those Americans, the plains that they had traversed in their prairie schooners were the plains that the plow had to break. Red Indians, the Native Americans, who defended their tribal territories were destroyed by assault or starvation or slow wasting away on reservations. Herds of bison were wantonly slaughtered. Buffalo Bill boasted that he had killed 4,280 in less than 18 months, and that was only one man's marksmanship. The white clouds of a blue heaven were simply there. It was the black clouds of smoke from the iron horse that stirred the blood. It was from these attitudes of the courageous but often ruthlessly exploitive pioneering Americans that Yosemite quaked in danger. Yes, a voice was needed.
Everyone needs beauty as well as bread. Places to play in and pray in, where nature may heal and cheer and give strength to body and soul alike.
And a voice was heard. It belonged to a man who was part naturalist, part scientist, and it would seem part biblical prophet, John Muir. He was destined to become Yosemite's greatest protector. Though born in Scotland, Muir was brought as a child to America by his parents, who settled in northern Wisconsin. At 22, he left home, earned some success as an inventor, and became a student at Wisconsin's University at Madison. But he felt a deep calling to trod the path of nature. This began a lifetime of long hikes to Indiana, to Canada. Even as a young man, he sported a prophet's beard. In 1868, the ship Nebraska sailed into San Francisco Bay. John Muir, now almost 30, was one of its passengers. San Francisco was a big, bustling town whose hills were as notorious as those of Rome, and it was bawdy. With the gold rush, it had mushroomed from a sleepy little mission to a metropolis. But city wildlife was not what had brought John Muir to California. Muir knew exactly where he was going. He headed straight for Yosemite.
I had read the description of the Yosemite Valley and thought of it most every day since.
When at last Muir beheld the valley, he became, in his own words,
born again.
A tireless hiker, he explored Yosemite on foot, from the chaparral to the alpine heights. He slept out under the stars. To him, he dwelt in the ultimate religious temple.
No temple made with hands can compare with Yosemite.
His writings abound in biblical-like references. A deeply religious man, Yosemite became his
baptism into nature's warm heart.
He studied everything. Every form of life caught his interest. Flowers, leaves, grasses, birds, animals, a feeling of oneness with all creation welled up in him.
Bears are made of the same dust as we.
Muir was drawn to the upper reaches of the area, the High Sierra. This old tree testifies to life's harshness in the high country. There are still living glaciers on Mount Lyell, glaciers formed within the span of human history. Glacier trails here are strewn with telltale boulders and ice-polished rock with a sheen like patent leather. Here the lakes are deep and cold, and snow can fall up to 5 feet in a single day. Here, the planet Earth is still shaping itself. Yet, to John Muir, the high country was
hospitable, kindly, tenderly inspiring. About as kindly as anything the heart of man can conceive.
Here, place names are closer to the Miwok language of the Awanichis. Tuolumne River. Tuolumne Meadows. Hetch Hetchy Valley. And a canyon named after old Chief Tenaya. Following these falls, one sees why they're called water wheel. The water moving backwards in its headlong sprint out of the mountains. Deep in this wilderness, Muir encountered his first glacier. Here, he formulated his theory of glaciation. It was the movement of the invading ice that shaped and sculpted Yosemite. Lying on a slope, he moved inch meal in imitation of an advancing glacier, just to get the feeling. Here, in the thin air of the high country, Muir found total fulfillment in nature. Not the nature that must be conquered of the American pioneer, but the nature of the American visionary.
Opening 1,000 windows to show us God.
Others shared this cosmic vision. Across the continent, voices were being heard from craggy New Englanders, whose flinty character fed on clam bakes, codfish, and Calvinism, was spawning souls such as Henry David Thoreau, who turned his back on society to live alone at Walden Pond.
I went to the woods because I wished to live deliberately, to front only the essential facts of life, and see if I could not learn what it had to teach. And not when I came to die, discover that I had not lived.
But Emerson's was the voice heard above others. Philosopher and intellectual rebel, Ralph Waldo Emerson, sage of New England, the waves of God beating upon his soul.
The heart which abandons itself to the supreme mind finds itself related to all its works.
Muir invited Emerson, whom he regarded as
a clear-souled guide upon the high ranges of truth,
to visit him. It was at the rough hang nest quarters of a sawmill in the Yosemite Valley that the 68-year-old Emerson visited John Muir. Together they
crowded eternity into an hour and an hour into eternity.
During his early years at Yosemite, John Muir earned his bread as laborer at a sawmill, and sometimes by tending sheep. He had come to despise sheep for their destructive grazing, and he scorned these four-footed chompers as hooved locusts. Already families of wild mountain bighorn sheep were being depleted by domestic sheep-borne diseases. Muir urged putting a halt to using Yosemite's high meadows for grazing. There were other outrages. Parties of hunters still roamed the area. It was taking years to drive off homesteaders and squatters out of the valley. And there was a wanton cutting down of trees in the high country.
Any fool can destroy trees. They cannot run away. God has cared for these trees, saved them from drought, disease, avalanches, and 1,000 straining, leveling tempests and floods. But he cannot save them from fools. Only Uncle Sam can do that.
Only Uncle Sam can do that. Administration was helter-skelter. The valley and the Big Tree Grove were managed, more often mismanaged, by brash politicians of the state legislature. Muir threw his weight behind a movement to bring Yosemite into the national park system. And in 1890, a Yosemite National Park was created. The U.S. cavalry bugled in to enforce regulations in an area that had been nationalized. For now, administration became a house divided. It was the watershed wilderness ringing the park that had come under federal control. The valley and Mariposa Grove were still under the state of California. An administration muddle was making mayhem of the land. 1903 found the finer folk of California in a dither of preparations. President Theodore Roosevelt was coming to Yosemite. Dignitaries, including the governor, were traveling to meet him. Luxurious accommodations were being readied. Fine china, silver plate, and a French chef were brought in from San Francisco for a sumptuous reception. Yes, a president was coming. But Teddy Roosevelt, a rugged outdoorsman of a president, chose to spend his time in Yosemite with John Muir, whom he respected and enjoyed. They camped together in Mariposa Grove and above Glacier Point and in a meadow near Bridal Veil Falls. The president's comment on the experience?
Bully!
Back in Washington, Mr. Roosevelt proposed a rejoining the Valley and Mariposa Grove to the nationalized areas. Congress gave its approval. Yosemite was healed. At last, a full-fledged member of the growing family of national parks. John Muir lived to become Old John of the Mountains, a passionate writer on the preservation of nature and something of a practical politician and lobbyist. He received honorary degrees from both Harvard and the University of Wisconsin. In Muir's day, the word ecology was hardly ever heard, but the life work of John Muir made the meaning of ecology understood to the generations of his time, and he demonstrated its importance to the future. Muir saw the wilderness as God's own temple, but most Americans weren't quite overseeing it as an adversary to be tamed in the name of progress. In the high country, these free-flowing waters belonged to the Tuolumne River. Muir's last great fight was to keep these waters free, rushing, tumbling, cascading into the glacier-quarried Grand Canyon of the Tuolumne. But these moving waters are shackled at the Hetch Hetchy Reservoir. A dam had been proposed inside the park to slake the needs of San Francisco. The Hetch Hetchy Valley was sacrificed by damming and flooding. Old John of the Mountains had fought hard against it.
Trees, springs, poetry, and religion. All sold to the highest bidder. As well, dam for water tanks, our cathedrals and churches.
It was a fight that John Muir lost. The dam was built where it stands today. 1914 was the year that the U.S. cavalry left the policing of Yosemite. In 1916, the rangers of the newly formed National Park Service took over. And in 1914, the year after the Hetch Hetchy Dam had been authorized by Congress, John Muir died. Poet, prophet, practical politician, he had seen the world in a new light, and his gospel was simple.
We all travel the Milky Way together.
In 1855, Yosemite saw about 42 tourists. Year by year, the number of visitors increased. In the early days, it was a long, bumpy trip by stage. This 1905 snapshot shows an actual stagecoach holdup taking place in Yosemite. The armed bandit, wearing a long light-colored coat, can be seen in the background. The coming of the automobile made the park, which now covered 1,200 square miles, easier to get to and easier to get around in. Tourism flourished. Tourists turned the noble black bear into a pesty scavenger. The few remaining Indians in the park donned feather bonnets, headgear utterly alien to the Awanichis, to have their pictures taken. But then, as today, despite multiple horsepower automobiles, many of the wilderness areas are reachable only by single horsepower, or by your own 2 feet. Today, visitors arrive in excess of 3 million every year. They come to celebrate the 100th anniversary of Yosemite as a national park. They come from every one of the 50 United States, and from Canada and Latin America. They come from Europe, Germany and Scandinavia, France and Britain. They come from Asia, Japan, India. They come to camp, to experience life more simply. They come to birdwatch. They come to feel a kinship with their fellow creatures on this planet. They come to rediscover the wilderness, and in so doing, discover more about themselves. Some come because of that odd melding of the tastefully primitive and the ruggedly sophisticated that's found at the old Awani Hotel. The Awani opened in 1927. This is one of the earliest buildings to weave American Indian motifs into its overall design. It's been named a National Historic Monument. Some come for sports, for trout fishing and crystalline mountain streams. Some come for rock climbing, big wall climbing here. For in Yosemite, this sport is unsurpassed. Some climbs last for days, the climbers hauling up their food and gear after them. What appears to be a sheer wall is actually a vertical desert. There's life here. On these ledges live plants and animals. Climbers train on small cliffs where the climbs are short. When they graduate to the big ones, such as El Capitan, the biggest exposed monolith in the world, they'll be reaching slopes that are millions of years old. Some come for winter. When the falls are frozen ice sculptures, when animals forage in the snow. They come for skiing. With high expectations, or with no expectations whatsoever, they come, some only once in a lifetime, and some each bright year of their active lives. But they come, come in the millions, some with sleeping bags and backpacks, others with the latest in luggage. Like the rings of a great tree, they come in generations. Rangers have their hands full, guiding, informing, aiding, policing. Economic opportunity is not the prime reason for the enlisting in the National Park Service. These men and women are rangers because they love their work. They're dedicated. Dedication is something that Yosemite brings out in people. It's a ranger's never-ending task to preserve this wilderness from destruction by the millions of visitors who are drawn here because of that wilderness. The Park Service is meeting this need to preserve. The mechanics of preservation are evident to every visitor in the bear-proof waste disposals. In the past, visitors provided bears with picnic tidbits as though they weren't pets. But bears aren't cute, they're wild animals. Grubbing after candy store goodies like spoiled brats, they'd tear open cars and campers for a Twinkie. Some got dangerous. Hence, bear-proof waste cans are seen everywhere. And the bears have been resettled in more remote areas of the park where their habits are uncorrupted by the human sweet tooth. There's a sidelight to preservation. The valley had been a place of oak groves and acorn gathering. The Awanichis, for whom acorns provided the staff of life, have perished. But a smallish bird, a woodpecker, is still with us. This woodpecker isn't hunting insects, which is what most woodpeckers are doing while drilling holes in trees. This bird is an acorn gatherer, and he's drilling holes for his cache. A neat piece of engineering. The acorn fits precisely into the hole that it's pounded into. John Muir had nothing but praise for bighorn sheep.
Possessed of keen sight and scent and strong limbs, leaping unscathed from crag to crag.
But bighorns had been absent from Yosemite, decimated by disease and gunned down by hunters, despite laws prohibiting hunting. Now there's a program to restore bighorns to the park. Sheep from a southern Sierra herd are driven into drawn nets. Tagged and tested and then released in Yosemite. An effort to restore nature's balance, which had been down-ended by human beings. For eons, forest fires have played a part in nature. With the coming of human beings, some fires have been kindled through carelessness and sometimes malice. It had been a Park Service policy to suppress all forest fires, to protect the trees. It seemed that fires brought only destruction. The charred, twisted skeletons of once living trees, the stench of smoky death clinging to the air. Now it's been learned that some of those fires regarded as life-destroying are really life-giving. Without fire, these groves of sequoias cannot perpetuate themselves. The Native Americans, the Awanichi, held these trees sacred, but they let nature handle things. Then we came along. When fires started naturally in these groves, as they had for thousands of years, we put them out. The destiny of these largest of all living things rests in a cone the size of a hen's egg. Every year, a mature tree produces 200 of these seed-bearing cones. The tiny seeds, 91,000 of them weigh only a pound, are released with the aid of cone-boring larvae and the chewing habits of the chicory. The tiny seed falls to the ground, and if conditions are right, sprouts a taproot. This has been going on for 150 million years. But conditions must be right. Duff, pine needles, leaves, bark, debris, on the forest floor, will prevent the seeds from sprouting. The seeds will rot or be attacked by fungus. Fire clears the forest floor and prepares the soil for seeding. And the heat of the fire dries out the cones so that the seeds will fall, sometimes showers of them, by themselves. Now we understand that fire is the ally of these great trees. Today, the Park Service is using controlled fires in preserving nature's way. The bark, up to a half a foot thick, protects the trees, and the foliage is unreachable by the lapping flames. In this way, these groves of giants are being preserved for future generations. Another preservation effort centers on the peregrine falcon, one noblest of the sharp-eyed, swoop-and-dive members of the hawk family. Decades of the use of pesticides have taken their toll. The shells of the peregrine's eggs are so thin and fragile that they crumble before the chicks hatch. Volunteers climb inch meal up a sheer precipice to an egg-warm nest, the females swooping frantically above. Daringly, the climbers ease the delicate eggs into their packs and replace them with porcelain eggs. The precious eggs are incubated and hatched in the ideal conditions of a laboratory. Hungry always, chicks are fed until they're strong enough to be brought into the wild. Now, climbers make the delirious ascent once more, this time to place the foundling chicks in the home sweet home of the nest. The edgy falcon may not grasp fully what's happening, but she and her mate will adopt the chicks as their own. This is another way that the Park Service is endeavoring to restore what others have come close to destroying. All who've gazed on it would agree. From those primordial humans who stumbled into this valley some 4,000 years ago. And the Awanichi acorn gatherers who built their villages here. And the visionaries who struggled to bring this wilderness into the national park system. To the millions who visit here. At all costs, this healing wilderness must be preserved. Yes, this healing wilderness. Yosemite is a miracle, constantly renewed, and there are those who experience moments here, moments of intense perception, even rapture. The philosopher Emerson described such moments as
the universal beauty
to which every part and particle is equally related. The eternal one.
Of such moments, John Muir rhapsodized,
"The winds will blow their own freshness into you, and the storms their energy."
To more ordinary men and women, such moments might be best expressed in the simple words of a Psalm of David. "Be still and know that I am God."